All right, let's talk tail draggers. They are definitely one of my favorite aircraft to fly. They are usually historic. Every single one of them is unique. They all have their own handling characteristics. They're challenging. They're not just something you can jump in, put in a notch of flaps and take off and land and call it good. They require some practice and some sort of like understanding of each aircraft. So today we're going to go through and practice and demonstrate the differences as you get to larger aircraft and how they affect sort of the way they travel through the air, especially the way they land and take off. So we are in the Cessna 140. It's a nice, small, light tail dragger that is great to start out in. We're going to work our way up. Like I said, next one is going to be the Cessna 195 business liner. Then we're going to go to the Beech 18, and then we're going to go to the DC-3. Guarantee you most of you are going to just fast forward to the DC-3, but I strongly recommend you just maybe taking a day, 2 days to go through and get comfortable with flying these smaller ones and work your way up, because it's going to get rid of a lot of that frustration when you understand what's actually happening. Let me just set my barometric pressure here real quick. We are at Burbank, California. We are lined up on runway 26. We're just going to do a very quick circuit in each aircraft. And for this aircraft and the 195, I'm going to demonstrate what you can do to practice understanding what's going on with that rudder, with that tail wheel. So we're only going to accelerate up to 50% throttle. So that way the tail will lift, but we're not going to take off. The other thing I'm going to do is I'm going to actually lower our flaps, so that way we do not have any flaps whatsoever. We are just as is. So let's go ahead and do that. We're going to, actually I think I still got the parking brake on. Let's go ahead and pop that guy off. And we're just going to come up to 50% on this guy. And you can already start to practice a little bit on what's going on and how much rudder needs to be put in. Now that tail's coming up, same again, let's just practice how much input needs to be done to keep you on that center line. Once you get comfortable with that, go ahead and just bring us all the way up to full power. We already have a lot of airspeed going and we can already rotate. But that's what I really recommend doing, just to get a nice feel for what's going on with the aircraft between tail wheel and how much input is required there, and then how much input is required when you actually have the tail in the air. Now we're going to cut this one pretty close here and pretty short, because we we don't need all that runway. Typically you would wait to the end of the runway before you made your turn, but we are just going to get us into a nice tight circuit here. So having a look there, looking pretty good. Already going to bring back that power a little bit here. Probably around 2300 RPMs. Yeah. So as you get used to these aircraft as well, you're going to start to recognize engine noises and RPMs and all that sort of good stuff. So we're keeping it low. I'd say maybe 500 feet AGL. And we already brought in that notch of flaps, we didn't bring it in yet. We were at no flaps. So I nosed up a little bit there, so we can bring that in. And then we can bring that nose back down, and that drag will help keep us under control a little bit with our airspeed. And we can go ahead, let's have a look here. Yeah, we're looking pretty good. Let's go ahead and introduce the second notch of flaps. And personally, I find that tail draggers, it's nice to keep the flaps not full. You don't want to go full flaps. The reason being is because when you come into land, you want some airspeed. We want a little bit of, less drag is what you want. And the reason being is we're doing what's called a two-wheel touchdown or a two-wheel landing. So you touch down with those wheels, you want to fly really just above the runway, and let the front wheels just sort of kiss that tarmac. And then you're going to let that tail naturally drop. The reason for that is that you have what's called rudder authority, where the rudder of the plane is actually controlling the aircraft versus that tail wheel. And this will come into more useful when we get into like the Beech 18 and the DC-3, where really you should be using a locked tailwheel. We're a little high here. We're just going to back off that throttle a little bit. I'm going to stay under 80. I always find this. I really should watch a video of runway 26 in real life, because there's a tree like dead center on the center line. If you were to aim for the numbers, there's no way you can hit them. But we've got long runway, so we're okay. We're gonna aim for the markers instead. And honestly, we'll probably go beyond those as we try and float this down to kind of just, like I said, kiss the tarmac. We don't want to slam into it. Now, I am self-admittedly a bouncer. Tail draggers, I will tend to bounce. There we are. We're at a nice 60 miles an hour. I'm not going to change the throttle here. I am going to keep that throttle in. Slowing down. You can see we're at 50. Just touchdown. And look, I still have that throttle in. We're at just less than 50%, just like before when we took off. That tail is just happy as can be. We can go ahead and slowly bring us to idle. And that tail is just naturally going to drop. There it goes. You're going to hear a little squawk. There it is. Now we can pull back on the yoke, apply some brakes, bring those flaps up, and go ahead and exit the runway. So that's the reason why you want to get used to flying these aircraft, the small ones, is you can see how that can transition into a much smoother landing in a larger aircraft. So let's go ahead and move on up to the Cessna 195. All right, so here we are in the Cessna 195 business liner, which is obviously a much larger aircraft. It does have a giant powerful radial engine on the front, which makes things very hard to see over. You can see even if we go to our sort of highest view, we cannot see over. You can tilt your head out to see that center line, but that really kind of makes it hard to see what's going on. So What I like to do is kind of have a look at the side of the runway to keep that basically staying with the aircraft to know that I'm staying on the center line. I still like to go to the nose up view or the higher view, I should say, to get a better idea of where we're at. And then once that tail comes up, that's when I'll drop down to the normal view. So we're going to try and do the same thing. It's a little trickier in this because it is more powerful aircraft. It's larger. That tail does need a little bit more thrust to get over it to get some rudder authority. But we'll go ahead and just advance that throttle. We're not going to go full throttle. We are just going to go ahead and get us rolling. Really what I want to look for is where that tail starts to come up, and there's a bigger reaction in this aircraft when the tail comes up. You can already hear it starting to sort of almost jiggle around a bit. I'm adding more right rudder, easing off that right rudder as that tail comes up, and back on the rudder a little bit. And you can see it is a little squigglier. We're coming to full throttle now. We'll drop the bird view back down, and we can go ahead and rotate. So I was doing minimal amounts of input there. There wasn't a lot going on, but you could see it had a greater reaction. And I did do a little bit of chasing it where I kind of let off a little bit too much on that right rudder and had to put it back in. So it takes practice. Honestly, going back to back on these aircraft does take a little bit of getting used to. As each one does handle differently on the ground. So we're gonna do the exact same thing, just do a very quick sort of pattern here. Just get an eye on where we're at. There we are. I'm gonna go ahead and level off here. Bring that power back a little bit. Trim us out. Now this aircraft does have one notch of flaps. It's not great at because it does come down to about 35-40 degrees. It's not great at, it obviously produces drag, but it's not great at really slowing you down all that much compared to another aircraft that would have like, you know, a 30%, 40% third or fourth notch of flaps. So we'll go ahead and lower those down now. You see it coming down. Gives us a good sight of the runway as well. So we've got that coming down. I'm going to go ahead and reduce the throttle a little bit more. Then we're going to make our turn to start coming in. Same again, you want to keep that power in when we touch down. You're going to really kind of focus on having that tail staying in the air, and that you are just going to touch down those front two wheels and do a two-wheel landing versus that three-wheel landing. Bring a little bit of power back in here. I definitely got a little slow there. I like to really kind of keep these approaches around 100 until we're on final. Much better now. Now I can bring that throttle back down again. That turn was burning off a little bit too much speed for the throttle I had in place. Like I said, those flaps really don't do a heck of a lot as far as messing with your actual speed, where normally you would use the flaps to slow you down. So now this is tricky because we do have this big nose. If you come up to the nose up view, which it kind of makes you feel like you're over when you're on the runway. So we want to kind of stay in this view. I'll see what it's like once I touch down. Little off center line here. I'm going to try and bring us over. I I think we'll be okay with this sort of view here. There's 80 miles an hour. And I'm going to keep the power in right around there. Just let it kind of float on down. And we're going to bounce. So now we can go ahead and come to idle. That's normal for that tail to do that. We can pull back and apply those brakes. So there we go. So not the best touchdown there with that big old bounce in there. I did a sort of better recovery on touching down those wheels, but you can see it does require a little bit more input as that tail lowers, because you lose a little bit of rudder authority between the tail wheel touching and the slower speeds. So let's carry on, and we're going to move up to the BH-18 and get some practice in that one. All right, so now we're getting interesting. We are now in the Beach 1-8, or the Beach 18, or the Twin Beach. You can see we have two big old radial engines on this. I'd say this is a mid-size compared to the DC-3 or something like the Boeing 247D. We're going to move up to the DC-3 after this one. Now, there's a few more complexities that go along with this aircraft. Obviously, it's going to be a twin, which means you do have sort of separate controls if you do have a throttle quadrant that allows that. We also have a tail wheel lock down right here. Now, it's personal preference, honestly, in the simulator. In the real world, that needs to be locked. You're going to see a lot of people say keep it unlocked. You're going to see some people say keep it locked. The reason why people like to have it unlocked is because it gives you a little bit more control while that tail is on the ground. Now, the problem with that is that you're going from using your tail wheel to then tail lifts, and then you're using your rudder. And it's kind of a harsh transition. So, personally, if you watch my other Beach 18 videos, I used to fly with it unlocked and would run into those problems. What I've found now is that it's better to have that locked and get that tail up into the air sort of as quickly as possible. And you're going to do that by coming forward on your yoke. As that tail comes up, you sort of ease off well, sort of pushing on the rudder pedals to keep it straight. As the speed increases, more or less is going to be needed on the rudder pedals. So let's just give everything a quick little wiggle here, get it all sort of, I like to say, zeroed out. And then we're going to go ahead and lock that tail wheel, and we're going to unlock our parking brake. Let's see how this goes. So same principle again. We're going to bring in our power nice and easily. Nice thing about this aircraft as well, you can come into your sort of higher view and see the center line. So I'm pushing forward on that yoke. You're going to start to feel that. There it goes. And then we can ease off the yoke, come back down. And right around here, we can already go ahead and rotate. So you can see there was some wiggling going on, bringing the gear up. That's also something new for this aircraft. Well, not new for this aircraft, but new for this sort of video. It's the first aircraft that we've had with projected gear. So we're going to go ahead and start climbing out. We already want to reduce that power, though, so we're going to come down to 30 inches of manifold pressure there, and then I'm going to bring the RPMs down around 1918, somewhere in that range. And that'll have a much happier engine for us. And since we're doing a circuit, we don't need to have crazy climb out power. Just gonna bring that wing up a little bit there, see how we're looking. Looking pretty good. We're gonna go ahead and start to level off here. I'm gonna drop that power even lower, bring it down to around 21 inches of manifold pressure. And we wanna, that's looking actually really nice. I like that. I haven't touched the trim. That is just using the power to get us to level out. Now, 115 is where we can introduce flaps, so I am going to bring that down right to the limit on the green. And I'm going to pull back on the nose a little bit here, or pull back on the yoke to bleed off some of that speed so we can introduce the first notch of flaps. So that's been lowered. I'm not sure if you can see it. Yep, we can see it just fine on this aircraft. So we're just going to start our descent. I like to keep this around 100 miles an hour for the descent. We can go ahead and already lower that landing as well. Introduce a little bit more drag so we can have, you know, really want to keep everything in the blue there, or sorry, in the green. And we're also going to come full forward on our prop switch. You can hear it didn't make a lick of difference there because of where our manifold pressure is. If the reason you go full forward is so if you have to do a go around, you are set to just push forward on the throttle and have basically full RPMs as well. I'm gonna go ahead and drop the second notch of flaps. So we have our gear down, two notches of flaps, runway in sight, descending right around 100 miles an hour. I want us to touch down right around 80-ish, maybe a little bit below that, and then we're going to let it roll out. Now, I'm, as you saw in that 195 video, the one right before this, for some reason I'm horrible at bouncing aircraft, so we're going to try and go for no bounce. It's just on these tail draggers. And I just think I need to hold off a little bit more to let the wheels just really touch down. We're bringing back that power. Now that tail wheel is still locked. Coming up to 80. Skim that little tree there. Right. Got a little bit of ground effect there. Come to that nose up view. Still out of bounds. I come to idle. That tail is dropping. There we go. Little bit of wing dip there. Forgot about that with this aircraft. We do have a little bit of tiny amount of crosswind, so you do get a little bit of a wing dip going on. We'll go ahead and pull back and apply the brakes. Bring those flaps up. ahead and pull off here. Oh, I forgot to unlock that tail wheel. So that might have been also why I had that wing dip there, is that as we touched down, I wasn't able to control that rudder anymore, and it kind of let us dip. So, you know, besides that little tilt of the wing, you can see that we rolled out. The stall horn did come in. I would have liked to have held a little bit more speed on that one, so that way it didn't happen. But overall, stayed on the runway. A little bit of wing dip or that one side wheel would have came up just a little bit, but we corrected it and stayed on the runway. Let's move up to the DC-3, which I'm sure that's why you're all here. Alright, so here we are, which I'm sure most of you just skipped right ahead to the DC-3 takeoff and landing section. But I do strongly recommend following the steps that I have shown throughout this whole video, because it really builds you up to making this a lot easier, instead of the frustration that a lot of people get out of trying to take this off. So, same real principles apply, especially to that H-18 that we just used. This is a much larger plane, by gosh, about three times the weight as a H-18. So it's definitely a larger plane. We do have same sort of principle here with all our controls, as far as, you know, multiple engines. We're gonna still lock out that tail wheel. This tail wheel is very hard to get to, though, so if you're using a mouse, your giant trim wheel gets in the way. So it is nice to have a shortcut key for that tail wheel. Same with the parking brake, is down there, that little red knob. So those two I would recommend having a keybind. Now I have the keybind for the tail wheel, and then our parking brake is now released. We're gonna attempt to do this the same way we did the H-18, where we want that tail up, and then we're going to ease it off, so that way we can get as much rudder authority as possible. Yet again, I just want to preface this. This is what I found best for flight simulator, not necessarily best for what the real world aircraft does. There's a lot of things that go into the flight model, who developed it, who interpreted the flight model within the constraints of flight simulator. So there is a lot of constraints to make each and every single one of these aircraft work as realistic as possible. The other thing to keep in mind is that there's no way I would be able to jump into a DC-3 and have a successful takeoff and landing as it stands now, with the very limited knowledge, without training, without anything like that, as far as this is concerned. So put that in perspective as far as, you know, how realistic you know, this might actually be. So with that being said, we're gonna go ahead and advance that throttle slowly. We are gonna push forward on that yoke to get that tail into the air, and control with our rudders as that tail comes up. There's usually a little bit more of quick inputs to get that to straighten out. I'd never go full, ever. So if you're going full rudder, that just means that you're gonna have to go full the other direction. So just really kind of do a little bit of a balancing act to get that lined up. And that's why I recommend starting off with smaller aircraft, because you really get a feel for what's going on before moving into these. I love this cockpit, because it's like you're in a tank. But here we go. We're going to go ahead and bring in that power. get that slowly rolling. We're going to go ahead and push forward on the yoke. There we are. We're at full throttle. There's that tail up. A little bit of right rudder. See, I went too much right rudder there. Airspeed is looking pretty good so far. We can go ahead and rotate. Bring our gear up. There we are. We can go ahead and same again. You want to reduce that power down. I hate where the manifold pressure is on this aircraft. It's way down there versus being like up here, like on the Beach 18. And we do want to bring our RPMs down as well. Somewhere around that 2200 RPM range. We'll probably reduce our throttle a little bit more once we get sort of established here. Went a little bit too far up with the nose. Climb rate on this is about 120. We obviously don't need to go too much beyond that as we are just doing this circuit. We're going to trim this out a little bit here. Bring back that throttle a little bit more. We want to make sure we're, yeah, see, you need to stay in that sort of green there, or blue on this one. But we are going to bring back those RPMs a little bit more, around 2000 to try and get some speed down. I started to come over to left a little bit. Let's go ahead and bring that nose up so we can introduce the flaps. There we go. And we're extremely high now. This aircraft has a hydraulic sort of pump for your flaps. Same again, I don't recommend going full flaps on this. There's not really a need because we want to keep that speed up. If you're doing a short field, soft field landing, you're going to go full flaps and do a three-wheel touchdown versus an asphalt landing, which is going to be a two-wheel touchdown. Let's go ahead and drop our gear. You can see we're up a lot higher than before. That was really down to me not controlling our speed all that well. I should have reduced that throttle a lot sooner. We're going to go ahead and come up to about half on our flap gauge there. Might have to do a little bit of a slip here to slow us down some more. Yeah, we're actually looking okay. We're gonna go ahead and come to 3/4. And that's where I recommend you stay. No need to go beyond that. Just watching that airspeed. So at this point, we're going to come full forward on our props. That's looking much nicer now. We're down to about 100 miles an hour. Come back to looking out the tank window here. But the same principles apply. Just gets trickier and trickier the larger the aircraft gets. Now, touchdown I found right around that sort of 80-ish miles an hour. Same thing as that Beach 18. You can go a little bit slower than that, but you really start to get some rattling and buffeting going on once you get a little too slow. We're at 90, a little high. Those silly trees here at the fence line really bug me. All right, here we go. going to leave that throttle in. Maybe back it off a little bit. Stay above the runway. Let that speed come down. There's 80. Nice. Come to idle. Staying on that center line, I'm going to go ahead and drop that tail down. And apply a little bit of brakes. Once we get under 40, I'm going to unlock that tail wheel. There, that tail wheel is unlocked. And we can go ahead and exit the runway. That might have been my best one out of all four. I hope this helps explain on how to land tail draggers in Microsoft Flight Simulator. Thanks for watching. I really would appreciate a thumbs up and a subscription if you enjoyed this video. Until next time, take care.